listeners, you are welcome to another episode of our weekly online chemistry class. In the previous episode, we talked about classifications of elements in the periodic table, where elements are classified into two classes. The first class was classifications into types, where we have metals, non-metals, semi-metals, or metalloids, noble gases, as well as hydrogen. The other classes of elements, or the other class of elements, are classifications into blocks. And in that class, we classify elements into S, P, D, as well as F blocks. Today, we are going to focus on quantum numbers. The importance of these quantum numbers is for us to be able to know how electrons are being arranged in an atom. At the end of this class, students are expected to know what we mean by orbitals, the various types of orbitals that we have, as well as the maximum number of electrons that can occupy each orbital. Then the types of quantum numbers that we have, as well as the application, or what is the importance of each of these quantum numbers in understanding of electronic arrangement in an atom. Orbital. By definition, an orbital is an acceptable wave function, as well as its associated energy, which is a function of the position of an electron in an atom. In other words, we can define orbitals as an environment where electrons are being located or are found in an atom. And generally, according to quantum numbers, we have various types of orbitals, which are S orbital, P orbital, D orbital, F orbital, among others. The S has a full meaning, which is known as spherical, that is abbreviated as S. The P is principal. The D is diffuse, while the F means fundamental. Fundamental. These are the meanings of the common orbitals that we have. Now, the mathematical representation of orbital is what we know as psi. We call this psi. That is, if you want to quantify the amount of electrons, or in terms of quantum classical models, we have what we call psi. Then we have four types of quantum numbers. Quantum numbers. The first type is the principal, which is also known as energy quantum number, that is represented as small letter n. Then we have the azimuthal or angular, also known as subsidiary quantum number, represented as small letter l. The third quantum number is magnetic, that is represented as m. Or in some text, you see it as M subscript small letter L. And fourth, we have the spin quantum number, represented as S or MS. Now, the principal quantum number. Principal quantum number N. This signifies the size of an atom. That is, how many orbitals or shells are present in an atom. And again, this principal quantum number also indicates the period an element belongs to in the periodic table. So the value of n indicates the number of shells that can be found in an atom. It also indicates the period of an element in the periodic table. So if n has a value of 3, it means the atom has 3 shells, and it belongs to period 3, because the period number of an element in the periodic table is the same as the number of shells that are found in that particular atom. And this n takes maximum values of 1 up to n. So n can be equal to 1, 2, 3, 4. So when n is equal to 1, it means the atom has 1 shell. and the element in the periodic table where N is equal to 1 are just 2. Those are hydrogen and helium. They have only one shell. So element in period 2, they have 2 shells each. That is from lithium to neon. And you observe that all of them, they have 2 shells and they are members of period 2. Now the maximum number of electrons that can occupy each shell is given as 2n squared, where n is the principal quantum number. We are coming to that. Now, if you have n to be equal to 1, that is designated as k shell. When n is equal to 2, we have l shell. When n is equal to 3, we have m shell. When n is equal to 4, we have n shell. And when n is equal to 5, N equals 5 is equal to O shell, and so on and so forth. Now let us look at how distribution, the electrons that occupies each shell are being distributed in an atom. Here we have value of N. We have the shell equivalent. Then we have the maximum electron, which is 2N squared. So when N is equal to 1, that is equivalent to K shell. So how many electrons can occupy this shell in maximum? N is equal to 1, that is 1 square 1 times 2, will give us 2. That means K shell, which is also referred to as the inner shell of an atom, takes maximum of 2 electrons, either 1 or 2. So when N is equal to 2, that is L shell. 2 square times 2 will give us 8. When N is equal to 3, N shell. 3 square times 2 will give us 18. When N is equal to 4, okay, this is M. This is N, N shell. 4 squared times 2 will give us 32. And when it's equal to 5, O shell will give you a total number of up to 50 electrons. But the problem is, are you not surprised that a particular shell in an atom takes up to 32 electrons? When you know that, when you are writing electronic configuration, especially the first 20 elements in the periodic table, you normally write 2, 8, 8, whatever, whatever. So the other quantum numbers are going to tell us why a particular shell is holding up to 32 electrons. So let's go to the second quantum number, which is azimuthal subsidiary or angular quantum number. That is represented as N. The angular quantum number indicates the number of subshells in a particular shell. How many subshells can be found in a shell of an atom? And how many electrons can occupy each subshell? So the subshells that we have, the angular momentum takes values of 0, 1, 2, 3, up to n minus 1, where n is the principal quantum number. That is, if you want to know how many subshells are there in a particular shell, just subtract 1 from the value of the quantum number of that atom. Then start from 0 up to that particular number that you obtain. That's the number of subshells. And the designation of L is 0 stands for S, 1 stands for P subshell, 2 stands for D subshell, 3 stands for F subshell, 4 stands for G subshell, and so on and so forth. And the maximum number of electrons that can occupy each subshell is equal to 4L, that is minus 2. 4L minus 2. That is, when L is equal to 0, okay, 4L plus 2. When L is equal to 0, of course, you have a total of 4 times 0 is 0 plus 2, 2. So that means this subshell takes maximum of 2 electrons. We are coming to that. Now, let us combine the angular quantum number and the principal quantum number and see how how they are related in terms of table. So we have N, we have shell, don't forget, and the maximum number of electrons in the shell, 4, okay, 2N squared. Then we have L, which is N minus 1. Then we have equivalent subshell, and we have maximum electron, which is 4L plus 2. Okay, so let's look into this. When N is equal to 1, that is the inner shell, the first shell, that is represented as K. The maximum electron, as explained here, is 2 times N squared, which is 2. That means we have a maximum of 2 electrons. So how many subshells are here? N is equal to 1. 1 minus 1 is 0. So that means we have only one subshell, which is 0. And that 0 signifies what? S. I've told you that here. That S, the coefficient of that subshell, is the value of the principal quantum number, the energy level, where that subshell is being found. So because this 0 or this S is found in the N equal to 1, that means the designation is 1s. And how many electrons can occupy this? 4 times 0 plus 2, 2 electrons maximum, which is equivalent to the number of electrons that can be found in K. When N is equal to 2, L shell, 2 squared times 2 will give us a total of 8 electrons, as explained here. So how many subshells are here? 2 minus 1, 1. You now start from 0 up to that value. So that means there are 2 subshells, which are 2s and 2p. I told you when L is equal to 1, you have a p subshell. So how many electrons occupies here? Again, we have L equal to 0. 4 times 0 plus 2 will give us 2. When L is equal to 1, 4 times 1 plus 2 will give us 6. If you add 2 plus 6, that will give you the total number of electrons that can be found in the second shell, which is L shell. When N is equal to 3, we have a shell of M, and the maximum number of electrons again is 18. So how many subshells are here? You have 3 minus 1, which is 2. Starting from 0, 0, 1, 2, we have 3 subshells. This S subshell is from the 3 energy level. This P subshell is from the 3rd energy level. Why this D is from the 3rd energy level? So we have 3S, 3P, and 3D. So how many electrons occupies here? 4 times 0 plus 2, 2. 4 times 1 plus 2, 6. 4 times 2 plus 2, 10. 10 plus 6 plus 2 will give us 18. So meaning these 3 subshells are found in the 3rd shell, which is M shell. Let's look at one more. When we have N equal to 4, which is N shell, 4 squared times 2 will give us 32. Okay, how many subshells? 4 minus 1, 3. Is 0, 1, 2, 3. Okay, so 0 stands for 4S, 1 stands for 4P, 2 stands for 4D, and 3 stands for 4F. How many electrons here? 4 times 0 plus 2, 2. 4 times 1 plus 2, 6. 4 times 2 plus 2, 10. 4 times 3 plus 2, 14. 14 plus 10 plus 6 plus 2 will give us 32. So that means all these subshells are found in this shell. And this is the basis of your electronic configuration ordering of orbitals. So in the nutshell, there is something I want you to take note of here. You can see that the value of N is equivalent to the number of subshells in that shell. When N is equal to 1, we have 1 subshell. When N is equal to 3, we have 3 subshells. When N is equal to 4, we have 4 subshells. Meaning, all members of period 4, they have 4 subshells, which are 4S, 4P, 4D, 4F. Although, it is possible that not all the subshells are filled up with electrons. There are some of them that may be empty, as we are going to see in our subsequent edition. Now, the 3rd quantum number is the magnetic. The magnetic quantum number tells us, but before we go to magnetic, the shape of the first three subshells are very, very important. So the shape of S subshell is spherical in nature. S subshell is spherical. This is a y-axis, z-axis, x-axis. This is S subshell, spherical. For P subshell, it has a dumbbell shape. A dumbbell shape where you have something like this. This is dumbbell. Y, Z, X. This is P subshell. Why for this subshell, we have a double dumbbell where you have something like this. Double dumbbell. So you see have Z axis, Y axis, and X coordinate. So this is D subshell. So you can see that P is double of S. Why D is double of P? That's why we call it double dumbbell. Now, the 3rd quantum number is the magnetic. Magnetic quantum number. That is represented as M or M subscript X. This indicates the number of orbitals that can be found in a particular subshell That is, a subject might contain more than one orbital. And how are we going to know that? The magnetic quantum number also tells us the degeneracy of subshells into orbitals. The degeneracy of subshells into orbitals. How many orbitals are found in a particular subshell? And the only subshell or orbital without degeneracy is S subshell. Because there is only one orbital that is found in that. We are going to see. So the magnetic quantum number takes off value plus or minus L. That is the value of the magnetic quantum number. So the plus or minus L, it means it takes value from plus value of L up to minus value of L, as we are going to see. If we continue from that table, okay, again, we have the value of N, we have the shell, then we have the azimuthal quantum number, N minus 1, then we have the magnetic quantum number, which is what? Okay. L equivalent. Then we have the magnetic quantum number, which is plus or minus L. And each orbital in an atom takes maximum of 2 electrons, which can either be 1 or 2. So when N is equal to 1, don't forget we said we have K shell, and this takes maximum of 2. So how many subshells are here? That has been indicated. 1 minus 1 is 0, which is what? 1s, which also takes maximum of 2. Now, how many? Okay, the equivalent here is 1s, maximum of 2. So how many electrons are found? I mean, how many orbitals constitute this subshell? That is plus or minus 0. Plus or minus 0 is 0. And 0 means 1s orbital. So that means in a K shell, you have only one subshell, which is 1s, and you have only one orbital, which is 1s orbital. Okay? So when N is equal to 2, we have L shell, 8 electrons. 2 minus 1 will give us 1, is 0, 1. Okay? So this is a maximum of 2 electrons, maximum of 6 electrons, as indicated in the previous table. So here you have 2s, and here you have 2p. So in that case, how many orbitals constitute this? That is plus or minus 0 is 0, which is 2s orbital in this subshell. How many orbitals are found in 1p? I mean in p subshell. That is plus or minus 1. We have plus 1 is 0, minus 1. You start from plus that value up to minus that value. That means in a p subshell, there are 3p orbitals. And those p orbitals are 2px, 2py, and 2pz. So if each of them takes maximum of 2 electrons, 2 plus 2 plus 2 will give you 6 here, which is equivalent to the number of electrons in this subshell, plus these 2 will give us a total of 8. Let's look at one more. When N is equal to 3, we have M shell with a total of 18 electrons. So how many subshells is 0, 1, 2? And that is 2, 6, and 10. So the number of subshells here, the subshell equivalent, are 3s, 3p, and 3d, as discussed. So how many orbitals are in 3s subshells? Plus or minus 0 will give us 0, which is 3s. Plus or minus 1, plus 1 is 0, minus 1. So we have 3p orbitals, which are 3px this time around, 3px, 3py, and 3pz. For d, what is plus or minus 2? We give us plus 2. Plus 1 is 0, minus 1, minus 2. That means there are 5D orbitals in 3D subshell. And those 3D orbitals are 3DXY, 3DYZ, 3DXZ, 3DY square minus, okay, 3DZ square minus, okay, 3DZ square, then we have 3DY square minus maybe S square or whatever. I've forgotten. the x, the xy, yz, xz, the z square, the x square minus y square, or so, whether x square minus y square or y square minus x square. The most important thing is that we have 5d orbitals. So when each of these takes maximum of 2 electrons, that is equivalent to a total of 10 electrons, which occupy the 3d. Now the difference in shape of the three orbitals of p is just their orientation. The orientation is in the px, for px, it means that the orbital is facing the x axis of the coordinate. This is x, y, z. For this is px. For py, the orbital will face the y-axis. Y for pz, the orbital will face the z-axis. The three orbitals have the same shape, but different geometry. Now, the last quantum number, which is the spin quantum number, that one indicates the spin quantum number s, that or ms, that indicates the orientation, the spatial orientation of an electron in each orbital. And the spin quantum number takes either of two values, which is plus half for an electron that spins up. That is when an electron stands like this, and minus half for an electron that spins down, when you have something like this. So no two electrons, we are coming to that, in the same orbital can have the same possible set of the four quantum numbers. So these are the four quantum numbers that we have. In our next episode, we are going to look at how electrons are being arranged in an atom based on the four quantum numbers, the ordering of orbitals. And we are also going to look at how you can determine from the electronic configuration of an element, the period of an element, the group it belongs to in the periodic table, the block of that element, then the valence electrons, how many electrons are in the outermost shell of that element without identifying the element, in case the symbol or the identity of the element is not properly revealed. And lastly, in the next episode as well, we are going to look at the various theories or laws that govern the arrangement of electrons in an atom or in various orbitals. Thanks for listening. Do not forget to subscribe to our YouTube page. See you again some other time. Thank you.